It is hard to believe that it's been 12 years since the iPad was first introduced on stage and 7 years since the iPad Pro and the Apple Pencil first came out. And with WWDC right around the corner, many of us are hoping, I would say probably even wishing, that Craig and the software engineering team knock it out of the park when it comes to iPadOS 16. But until then, we are talking about 10 things the iPad can't do in 2022. And we're not just talking about the iPad Pro, we're talking about all the iPads. The gloves are coming off, even my beloved iPad mini. So, my name is Mike, let's get started. Number 10 is multi-user support. It's really hard for me to believe that in 2022, we do not have the ability to share a single device with many users in our household and our friends, it doesn't necessarily matter, and allow them to pass a device from one person to the other and have each have their own home screen, login, messages. Why is that not possible? What is going on, Apple? Where is this feature at? Why is it only available to education? It does require the iPad to do a full reboot in order to have that feature when it's enabled. Maybe it has something to do with the way that messaging works. Maybe it has something to do with the storage size of the device. They need to make some considerations. I really want them to bring this feature to all of the iPads, and whether you're in education or not, it would be great if it didn't require a full reboot of the device like how it does today. This is a must have, and I really want Apple to deliver this at WWDC coming up next month. Number 9 is app density. If you've used iPadOS 15, you know that the app density can look a little weird. You know, the grid spacing is a little too much, and this looks ridiculous. This is so small, and depending on how old you are, depending on how bad your eyesight is, it's kind of hard to read. This runs at 3x, and it's just a little bit too small. I wish Apple gave us the ability to not only increase the number of apps that you would have either per row or per page, but also the ability to increase the widget size. Like that would very much help, I think, for a lot of people. And Apple tried to address some of that by allowing you to change the size of the icon, so giving you bigger icons, but they don't allow you to change the grid spacing. But I really want Apple to address the app density in iPadOS 16, not just on the iPad mini, but even on the iPad Air, the iPad Pro, on the iPhone, you know, that's another device as well. Now, good thing you have the ability to change the per app text sizing, which is another great feature that they added this year, but it's not something that all apps support, and I wish it would be able for Apple to enforce it. But to me, app density is another big thing that you still cannot change in 2022. I mean, come on, let's just get with the program, guys. Number 8, face unlock and unlock with Apple Watch. Now, if you're anything like me, you probably depend on your iPad a lot to accomplish everyday tasks, whether it's replacing your iPhone, like my iPad mini has done for me, or you're using your iPad Pro or your iPad Air to replace your computer or supplement your computing. It is probably a very important part of your computing experience that you use on a daily basis. Well, the problem is with these devices that support Face ID, you know, if you're outside and you're wearing a mask, because obviously there's still a pandemic going on, and you want to unlock your device, you can't without taking off your mask. Well, you can face unlock with mask on your iPhone, but why can't you do that on the iPad? Or why doesn't the Apple Watch work with my iPad or my iPad mini to say that I can unlock it when my watch is near? That's a really critical feature, and it's amazing that you still cannot unlock your iPad while wearing a mask or with an Apple Watch on without actually having to pull, you know, your mask off. I really like to see this feature come in iPadOS 16, and I think it's just about time. They have enough data, they should be able to, I would say, kind of forklift it from the iPhone into the iPad and make it work for us. I would really love that feature. Let me know what you think about that down in the comments below. Number 7, CarPlay. In my opinion, one of the greatest features of the iPhone is the ability to use CarPlay with your device. Where is the support for your iPad? Now, I think it's kind of weird that Apple just left this off the table. Maybe they think that no one's using their iPad in the car. I could tell you that I would love to use my iPad mini connected to my receiver in my Subaru and to get it to work for CarPlay, because I'd like to have those directions. I'd like to have a bigger screen. When you use the iPhone as an adjunct or an adjunct display to the CarPlay, you get a little bit more information. You get the turn-by-turn directions, and I'd like to see that in a bigger screen. Again, that's just, it's kind of weird to me that Apple doesn't support CarPlay as a feature. Is something that Apple needs to do, though I don't think it's really high on their priority list. I just don't. Number 6, expanded USB and Bluetooth support. If you use a keyboard or a mouse with your iPad that's not first party, not made by Apple, you notice that there's probably lackluster support, and there's probably a stigma around using Bluetooth keyboards with your iPad. Everyone says there's a delay, it's not necessarily a good typing experience. One, I'd like to see Apple solve that for good. I don't want to see that anymore. Second, I love to see Apple address the ability to, you know, assign key combinations like you can to certain mice, certain keyboards, where you can do these kind of combination functions with those devices, because, you know, the standard function keys that are on the Apple keyboard or even on the Logitech keyboard, the Bridge keyboard, they're great, but I would love to do other things than that. I'd love for Apple to open up third parties where they could have apps like the Logitech app that allows you to configure the keyboard and much, much more. Now, but there's also a few other things that I'd like to see Apple address, and one namely is going to be expanded support for different USB-C use cases. Like if I wanted to record my podcast or even record this video using the iPad and my audio recorder that I have here, which is USB-C, I can, but I can't capture the data that's coming off, you know, over the interface, which is just kind of weird that they haven't expanded the number of use cases. You know, you want the iPad to be your, you know, almost catch-all device that you have when trying to solve a problem, because again, it's a tool and you use it to solve problems. I'd love to see them, again, support that as well. If you have any use cases that require USB that I didn't talk about, because, you know, it's only a limited set, let me know what those are down in the comments below. Number five is external monitor support. Now, we've talked about this for 5 years since the iPad Pro first came into existence. We really want the ability to take our iPad Pro and connect it to a larger display. Now, this might be coming given that Apple released the Studio Display and the fact that there's talks from Mark Gurman that there's this new feature coming in. I think they call it Mixer, which is a way of an app that runs part of iPadOS that automatically expands and scale app windows if you are plugged into an external monitor. That would be really great. But even if you can, I hope Apple fixes the fact that if I plug in my iPad Pro into a monitor, it runs in a 4:3 aspect ratio. There are black bars that frame the content, which looks ridiculous. And the fact that if I close my iPad, the screen on my display still stays lit, even though it is closed. You can't even use your iPad in clamshell mode. Again, if you want to use your iPad as a true desktop replacement, good luck. Number four is the ability to install apps that are not coming from the App Store. Now, this might be a contentious subject for some of you that are out there, but it is coming. I can only believe that it's coming based on some of the antitrust talks that have been going on with Apple in a number of different countries. If they're able to evade that, I don't know how they do it, but I would love to see the ability, you know, again, in 2022, if you're using your device as your sole computer, there's got to be a way to allow for apps to be installed outside from the App Store. They do it on the Mac, and there should be no reason that they can't do it on the iPad as well with some type of gatekeeper type functionality, which is what they use on the Mac. It's still hard to believe that you can't do that in 2022. I mean, come on. Number three, interactive widgets. Apple gave us a preview of what the future would look like in iPadOS 13 with the introduction of widgets in the sidebar or in the Today view. Took their foot off the gas a little bit in iPadOS 14, but iPadOS 15 really delivered the goods and allowed us to use widgets anywhere in iPadOS. But I really think we need to take this to the next step and start using widgets in an interactive manner so that we could actually use the widget and have information at our fingertips without needing to drill into the app or having the app opened when we click on the widget. It seems like it's just a step too much. Now, we all know Apple likes to increment things very slowly. Change is slow until it's not, but I would love to see Apple change this in iPadOS 16. Let me know what you think down below. I think interactive widgets is really a good contender for Apple to consider in iPadOS 16. Number two, the fact that you are forced to reformat drives using a Mac or even, you know, heaven forbid, a Windows PC, and you can't format them on iPadOS 15. Really, what in the heck is going on, Apple? Why can't I reformat the drives? I can rename the files, can't reformat the drives in APFS or any other format that I want to. I'd love to see this functionality come to iPadOS 16. Where are you at? And the number one thing that you cannot do in 2022 on your iPad, drum roll please, it is use the first party weather app. I mean, but seriously, there's a number of apps that are still not available on the iPad. There's obviously no weather app. There's no calculator app. I mean, come on, I gotta pay $5 for a calculator app in 2022. There's no health app. I can't see my health data. I can't delete iMessage cache on the iPad. You can't even record ProRes on the iPad Pro. You have to use the iPhone, which is kind of silly because the processor on the iPad Pro is more powerful than it is on the iPhone. I don't know what's going on there. Now, there are a number of other things that I didn't include, which I'm going to pin down in the first comment below. Let me know what you see in there, and maybe it's relative to you or not. If there's something I didn't talk about and you want to see the release in iPadOS 16, comment down below. My name is Mike. You know, I hope you had a good time today because I enjoy talking to you. Subscribe if you like this type of content and hit the like button if that is what you are into. I'll talk in the next one.